It's my pleasure to yield 5 minutes to my friend, my colleague, gentleman from South Carolina, the chairman of the Budget Committee and also a member of the Armed Services Committee, Mr. Spratt.
The gentleman from South Carolina is recognized for 5 minutes.
I thank the gentleman for yielding and rise to support the resolution and to talk about something the president seldom mentions, the cost of the war in Iraq. In deciding what we should do, cost is not the determining factor, but it is considerable. And with cost overall approaching $500 billion, it has to be a factor. During the first Persian Gulf War, we had real allies, Britain and France, the Gulf states, Saudi Arabia, and our gross cost was around $800 billion in current dollars. But Saudi Arabia and the Gulf states contributed in kind about $16 billion, and allies like Germany and Japan and Saudi Arabia contributed in cash around $60 billion, so the net cost to the United States was a mere $4 billion. Because we had allies willing to share the burden, the cost of the first Gulf War was minimal. But in this war, our president was able to enlist only one major ally, Great Britain, and he chose to go it alone with a motley coalition. That's one reason this war is proving more costly than the first, in lives and in dollars. So far, over 3,100 servicemen and women have been killed in action. So far, over 23,000 have been wounded in action, many of them grievously. And so far, Congress has appropriated $379 billion for the war in Iraq. As we speak, two supplemental appropriation bills are on deck. One is to cover operations in Iraq for the rest of fiscal 07, and it provides $100 billion to the $70 billion provided last year. The other supplemental is to cover operations in Iraq during fiscal 08, and it provides $145 billion. These bills, when passed, will push appropriations for the war in Iraq over $600 billion. $600 billion. When the 08 supplemental is added to the 08 base budget, these two will push appropriations for fiscal year 2008 alone to $643 billion. In constant dollars, that's more than we spent at the peak of Korea or Vietnam. In a few weeks, we'll enter the fifth year of our engagement in Iraq. Now, you would think that after 5 years, spending would come down. But spending over this time has not come down. It has gone up. 3 years ago, 2004, the Pentagon was obligating money for Iraq at the rate of $4.8 billion a month. Today, the Pentagon is obligating money for Iraq at the rate of $8.6 billion a month. And considering the supplemental for 07, with $170 billion and the surge in Baghdad, the obligation rate will probably rise to $10 billion a month by the end of this year. To support this surge, the president has called for five brigades, 21,500 additional troops. He sent us a supplemental of $3.2 billion to pay for these troops. The CBO says, how about the support troops? How about the staff? This will cost billions more. CBO has also looked out 10 years and tried to figure what future costs might be. By its estimation, future operations in Iraq and Afghanistan together could come to $824 billion between 2008 and 2017. And mind you, this assumes that the troops deployed in these theaters will be declining from a little over 200,000 today to a steady state of 75,000 in 2013. If future costs are split 75-25, then there is another, over the next 10 years, another $600 billion in store for us. Surely at this juncture, as spending surges, heads upwards to more than $10 billion a month, surely we should ask whether we want to raise our commitment of troops and thrust them into a civil war with no clear exit, no timetable for completion, and worse still, an urban war. The Pentagon will say they can't see past 2008, and they don't know what to budget for the out years, and they'll probably dispute this end state of 75,000 troops in the two theaters 10 years from now. And I hope they're right. But there are other costs, the cost of reset, of refurbishing and repairing our equipment, which our commanders have told us could easily be $60 to $70 billion to go. And I haven't talked about the toll on our troops and their families, but some will soon be going for their third tour. The dwell time between tours is now 1 year instead of 2 years. Whenever you go into the field to visit these troops, you have to be impressed with their attitude, with their readiness to serve and their willingness to sacrifice. I've always come away from these experiences saying, thank God there are such Americans. They deserve our admiration and support, but they also deserve something else. They deserve not to be asked to do what Iraqi troops and Iraqi police should do themselves. For the past 2 years, the Bush administration has said to us, just forbear, just wait, because we are training Iraqi forces, and as soon as these forces are stood up, ours can be stood down. Well, 118 Iraqi battalions have been stood up, and none of ours have been stood down. In the Defense Authorization Act, could I have 1 minute?
This time has expired.
I yield the gentleman an additional 30 seconds.
In the Defense Authorization Act for 2006, Congress enacted this policy into law. We call for 2006 to be a year of transition. The resolution before us embodies that notion. The resolution heeds that advice. It does not call for pulling out our troops. It does not call for cutting off our funds. It says simply but solemnly that we disagree with the surge of our troops. We're thrusting them into what the latest intelligence estimate is called self-sustaining sectarian violence, especially when there are more than 118 Iraqi battalions trained to take on that task.
Gentlemen's time has expired.
It is time for them to stand up and us to stand down, and Baghdad is a good place to start.